Well, I'm really grateful to be here, and what a great event. I have seen traction over the years being based in Silicon Valley, and the amount of quality that comes out of this event, from the content to the experience to now be here with it, just been really thrilled to do it, and big ups to the entire team for organizing it. I'm going to talk about the ultimate playbook for building communities, super fans and evangelists, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit about these three things: creating a community first, then why superfans are important, and then the playbook for your company to be successful. 10 years ago this week, I quit my job at Electronic Arts. It was in the middle of the Great Recession. My parents were thrilled with my decision. It was made more dramatic by the fact that a few weeks before I quit, my wife had her first child. And we've since had 4 children. I have 2 little girls and 2 boys. And the thing that I love, oh, those aren't my kids. They're the kids in the bottom. Those are 2 Acapulco divers from Mexico. And now that I look at this photo, I'm thinking we should not be using it anymore. The first 3 years of my entrepreneurial career can be summed up by basically I built things that I thought were cool without asking anyone else if they thought they were cool. And the only thing consistent about those 3 years is every 6 months, I would fail more spectacularly than the previous six months. But along the way, a friend and I launched this community called Startup Grind, which is designed to help startup people get educated, inspired, and connected. If anyone in the room has ever heard of Startup Grind or been to a Startup Grind, please raise your hand. Is there anybody in here? Okay, great. Anybody here not ever heard of Startup Grind in the last 10 years? Where the heck have you people been? Shame. No, I'm just kidding. It's okay. Now you have. So the next time I do it, you can raise your hand. But we created this global community, and it started as just a single event in my office in Silicon Valley. And there was 9 of us, and we were talking about our products, and we were sharing ways to help each other and making friends, and it was good enough to do again. So for the next 6 months, we hosted an event every month, and after about 6 months, I decided to invite everybody to go see The Social Network. So we went to a screening of this, and at the event was myself, my co-founder, and 2 other people. It was 4 people that showed up. And I got in my car that night, and it sort of felt like this. And if any entrepreneurs or founders, how many of this room are actual founders? Do we have founders in here? Yeah, maybe about half. You maybe experienced this. We've all experienced this at some point of our lives in some aspect of our professional careers. But as I sat there, sort of for the first time, something happened. I had this sort of epiphany. And I thought, well, why have I been just looking out for myself. Why am I not looking out for actually the customers? And so I looked back at the last 6 months, and there was one event that really stood out. We'd invited somebody to come speak who was a successful founder and investor, and people loved it, and about 20 people showed up. So we decided to do that, and I decided we're going to give it a couple more events. We'll try it, and if it doesn't work, it'll just be another log on my, you know, raging failure fire. But the next month, people did show up. We had a founder who had sold his company to Oracle, and 40 people were in the room, and I didn't really know any of them. I met everyone that night, and still to this day, almost 10 years later, I'm still friends with many of these people. In fact, that person on the front row in that jacket, his name is Daniel Cooperman, and he's product marketing director at Snowflake. I saw him just a few weeks ago. I'd never met him before this event. That's sort of the connection that has always been with Startup Grind. So that worked, so we decided to do it again. And the next month, 50 people came, and the month after that, 80 people came. And at that point, I basically exhausted all of my famous or successful friends network. And so I started cold emailing people. And I cold emailed an entrepreneur, and he said, look, I'd be happy to come speak, but I don't have time to prepare a talk, so you need to just interview me, and then I can leave right after. You need to prepare the experience to help me. And so that's exactly what we did. And so from that point on, you know, really is this turning point of we really just focused on what our customers needed and wanted. And I just sort of refused to spend my own money, other people's money, and more importantly, time on, you know, just frivolous things that I thought would be cool or that I thought were a great idea. A few months after that, an entrepreneur walked up at the end of an event and he said, I love Startup Grind. Like, I love the brand. I love the values. I love the community. We've got to do this in Los Angeles. I said, well, awesome. How many startup grinds have you been to? He said, well, this is the first one. I said, well, you must know there are probably 20 of these there. And he said, there aren't. And he was persistent, and he came to and said, look, I need you to help me. I want to elevate myself. I'm trying to build a business. I want to meet some of these people. I need you to help me, to give me this opportunity. And so we did, and it worked. And we started hosting events in Toronto and New York and even here in Vancouver, which we've been doing for many years. Today, Startup Grind has 600 active chapters in 125 countries. We've hosted over 10,000 events and educated tens of millions of people. No one is surprised by its success more than me, honestly. All the things I worked incredibly hard on, none of them, I worked as hard as I worked on Startup Grind. It was just nobody wanted them, and they all failed until this. I'm gonna tell you a couple of quick examples of wins and outcomes that have come from building a community for us. The first is a speaker came to an event and he pulled me aside after and he said, look, do you know what's special about Startup Grind? He said, it's the values. He said, it's about making friends, it's about giving, it's about helping others. And I said, well, yeah, obviously that's what it's about. He said, no, it's not obvious. You need to tell people. And so that night or that afternoon, I went back to my office and we put the values on the website. And it became like one of those lights that you take camping to like kill the mosquitoes. You know, it just like started attracting all of these really interesting and good people that reflected these kinds of values. And so this is one of the most important things. It's one of the most important designs or pieces of software we ever built. It wasn't really software, but just putting these on our website became a catalyst for growth. We've hosted more than 10,000 thought leaders and entrepreneurs and venture capitalists and told their stories from the founders of Twitch and WhatsApp and Instagram and YouTube. And we've shared that knowledge free across the internet. Millions of people have watched those videos and hopefully learned from those examples. One day I was sitting in our office and I was searching the hashtag Startup Grind and I found these amazing pictures from an event that had just happened. And I turned to the person next to me, our only employee at the time, his name was Francisco. I said, Francisco, he had been onboarding and training all these groups. I said, when did we launch the chapter in Bobble? Like, this is incredible. Look at this event. I mean, some of those people look a little upset, but other than that, like, it looks like a great event. And he looks at it, and he looks at me, and he looks at it, and he looks up, and he's like, man, I'm sorry to tell you this, but we don't have a chapter in Bobble. And frankly, I don't even know where Bobble is. And I thought, I don't know where Bobble is either. Does anyone here know where Bobble is? Yeah. It's in Iran, 200,000 person city, great knowledge, 200,000 person city in Iran. And we're like, well, let's get this person on the phone. Maybe we should work together since they apparently like what we're doing. This is what communities do. And I'll tell you 99.9.5% of all the things that the community has created, whether we told them to or not, has been good and positive. I've interviewed lots of founders. I've had lots of interesting experiences with some of these people we've all read about in like Forbes and other places. One of my favorites is that I interviewed the founder of Electronic Arts. His name is Trip Hawkins. He like created the interactive entertainment category. He was the 40th employee at Apple before he left and started EA. And I said, hey, if you could create the greatest startup team of all time from any era, who would be the co-founders? And he sat back for a minute and he said, okay, well, of course first, Steve Jobs. He's the CEO, he's the visionary. You know, Trip had worked for him, he knew better than anybody that you had to have this person on the team. And he said, of course, if it's a startup, we gotta have great technical depth. So I'm gonna go with Mark Andreessen, who basically created the internet browser. And you know, has been on the Facebook board and advised lots of great startups. And he said, and finally, I'm gonna bring Jesus onto the team because culture is gonna be key to what we're doing, and who better to do that than Jesus? So I said, okay, great team. A little more diversity next time, but you know, good try. So 3 months ago, I was in London. These two people, it's a true story, these two people walked up to me at our event. The team, the MyPick team, he said, look, I attended a Startup Grind a few years ago, I went down to the tube and got on the train, and I was sitting there, and I looked at the person sitting across from me, and it was the founder of Shazam, and I'd just seen him speak. I said, "You're the founder of Shazam." And the founder of Shazam's like, "No kidding." And he's like, "Hey, can I get coffee with you?" He's like, "Sure." And they became friends, and the founder of Shazam introduced him to a bunch of different people. He ended up raising several million dollars in funding just from that one experience that came from him attending Starkrine. The other entrepreneur on the right, somebody I'd never heard about, never met until a few months ago, he walked up to me and said, "Can I just talk to you for a second?" I said, "Of course." He said, "Look, I'm from Latin America. I came to your event in February. I brought my whole team. It cost a ton of money." I'm like, "Oh, geez, this is not going good. I'm really sorry, whatever happened." He's like, "I made $140,000 from the relationships that I got at that event." And I was like, "Let's take a picture, please." So, like, again, could have never predicted that these things would happen. And finally, we have our chapter director from Houston, who's one of our super fans, and her name is Michelle Price. And Michelle has been educating, helping people for years in Houston, and during the horrible flooding and, you know, weather that they had a few years ago, she lost her car, she lost her house, she lost all of her possessions. And the moment that we found out, we're like, we have to do something. The whole community rallied around her. We had people in Nigeria sending her $5. You know, we had people all over the world supporting her. We raised $20,000 for her in a matter of a few days to help her get her life back together. These are the kinds of things that you can do when you build a community. Things you don't predict, things you don't expect, but when you trust your customers and trust people who are asking you, and you just genuinely help them. Why are super fans important? Let me tell you. There we go. Super fans are important because the way people are buying has changed. Okay, so used to be you would hire a salesperson, and then it was a big advertising campaign, and now it's digital ads or fake ads. And the future is what we've historically called word of mouth, which is sort of like this magical thing that just happens if you're Zoom or Slack, which I've heard people talking about today, right? We all wish we had built that product. I never have. I hope you have, but you probably haven't. So how do you engineer word of mouth? How do you engineer customers talking to other customers on your behalf? You're a startup. You have nothing. No one cares about what you're working on except for your parents and one of your sisters. You have nothing. I've been there. So you have to engineer people to help you, and your customers are your best advocates. Trust has been broken. 3% of people significantly believe what they read when they go to social networks and read ads on social networks. 3%. 30% of millennials don't trust what they read online. 22% of Gen Xers. These are the people that are buying your product. And if your whole strategy is Facebook, which mine has been for many different things, it's not working. Millennials are just plain lonely. 22% of the millennials said they had no friends. 27% said they had no close friends. 25% said they had no acquaintances. You know, we all know what this means, right? You know what this means. It means the next time you see a millennial, give that person a big hug. That person is lonely. They have no friends. Just wrap your arms around that person. Tell them life's going to be okay. Look to your left and your right now. Is there a millennial? Do not hug that person. You will get thrown out of the conference. That is against the code of conduct. When you go to work, do not hug the millennials. You may lose your job. And that will not become a slide in my next talk. If you see a stranger, if you're in the bus, hug them. Go for it. See how that goes. Look, machine learning and AI are changing the world. They're going to take away all of these mundane processes that nobody wants to do, that don't bring any creativity into our lives. And what that's going to do is it's going to open up tons of space for us to move up Maslow's hierarchy of needs into the things we really care about. The future of marketing is communities, okay? It's humans interacting with humans. We call it customer to customer. And with the advent of SaaS and the subscription models, which how many people here have a subscription model or hope to have a subscription model? Me included. We have to touch customers all the time. You can't always text them. Heaven forbid you email them more than once a week. You know, we can't, or you call people, never call people. Oh my gosh, it's terrible. So what are you gonna do? You've gotta find other ways to touch people. And the best way to do that in a startup, get your customers, get other people to help. Traditional companies, position themselves in the minds of customers, but customer companies position themselves in the lives of their customers. Make my life easier. Make me experience things. How do you create this experience for somebody? C2C brands create opportunities for companies, not just professionally. This is the other really key insight to this. It's also personally. How can I make my customer's life personally better, right? How can I put something on their LinkedIn? Yes, that's how you can make their life personally better that way. You can help them get a next great job. You can help them get promoted, which is going to make them more money, which is going to make their spouse happy. Okay, should give them a better marriage, maybe. Actually, that doesn't actually happen. But if you have, go see a counselor if that resonates with you. So experience drives reviews, and reviews drive success, right? So Bevy's five-star review is because we spend thousands and thousands of hours at all points of the customer, in engineering, in care, in sales, in marketing, in everywhere. We've spent this time with them. And what are these reviews, what impact do they have? Well, hopefully if you ever think of Bevy again, you'll think, wow, I don't know anything about it, but I know it was five stars. When people look and search the search engines, when they go look, they see what other customers are saying about our product. The world is changing. This is a shot of a Pokemon event with a company called Niantic. If you play Pokemon Go, probably not, your kids might. But they bring thousands of people together around the world. Tim Cook said, there is nothing that replaces human interaction. Alexis Ohanian, the guy that created Reddit, said that people are moving away from social networks and into communities. And the great news is, your customers want to help. 84% said they want to share their perspective with a buyer. 22% said buyers have written a review. We had the CMO of SurveyMonkey, this huge customer experience company, saying that customers will do more if you just treat them nicely. And finally, I want to share with you, well, how do you do this? I'm a small company. Like, what have I got? I can only do so much. Trust me, I've been there. One of the things that has most surprised me in working with a lot of the biggest companies in the world is that the playbook, the methodology that we had at Startup Grind, this tiny little startup, is almost identical to the way that big companies manage these kinds of programs. The only variance is maybe the scrappiness of a founding team, right? And you maybe don't get that in a big company. But there's two key things I want to share with you. First, if you're just generally interested in this, go Google the space model. If you want to figure out how am I going to do community marketing, this is a program created by someone named David Spinks from a community called CMX. It's the premier community for community marketing people where they get their knowledge. But go Google this and learn how people structure their community programs. Secondly, I'm going to share with you 7 tips that I have learned for engaging superfans. The first, you got to get the mission and values down. You got to put them on the front of the website, and it needs to inspire. If you're selling B2B enterprise software, you can still find something inspiring in that. You need to build an education program. It needs to be education focused. You can't have your sales leader telling you what kind of community you're going to build. You need to do it from the heart and genuinely wanting to help people. You need to identify your super fans, and you need to do everything you can to help them professionally and personally. You need to build it for scale. Paul Graham said it famously, do things that don't scale. Of course, you can't lose that common touch with your customers. And that great example we had in that talk about sending somebody ice cream that asked for ice cream, that's not scalable. The Ben & Jerry's SurveyMonkey partnership is not happening. But you can do it on an unscalable basis, and it can have a huge impact. Create value for everyone. Remember my story about the speaker? He wanted his value. I want to come in, give an hour mentorship, and I want to leave. Let's create value for him. Let's create value for the attendees. Let's create value all across the chain. You need to show ROI, or your program's going to get cut, even at the earliest stage. I talked to a big $2 billion startup the other day, and they said, our community program improves NPS, it improves retention, it improves acquisition, and they just spouted off all of these numbers. That's what you have to do with any marketing program, but especially your community program. And never yell at a volunteer, because it's just me. Duolingo, I'm going to share 3 examples, and then I'll be done. Duolingo is a completely digital product. They have hundreds of millions of users. They wanted to take it into the real world. 2 years ago, they started. This month, they did 2,000 events across the world run by their community, incredible scale from a completely digital product. People are looking at Duolingo in a new way. Salesforce, it's a CRM, it's an enterprise product. They have turned it, you know, the characters, the brand, like the values, they have made Salesforce into one of the great companies in technology. They just announced their 1,000th community group, and look what Tiffany said about it. When my husband and I decided to become co-leaders of the Orlando's Salesforce developer community in January, we had no idea how amazing it would be. This is a CRM impacting people's personal and professional lives. And finally, authentically build communities you care about. This is my Palo Alto baseball team. It's my son's team that I get to coach. And the thing I love about kids' sports, it's the best community other than Star Wars. But it's great because everyone's doing it because they really care about it. Nobody, it's so much time, it's so much effort. You have to babysit other people's kids sometimes. Like, people want to spend time with their own kids, so they coach their kids, and they just genuinely want to help. And that's what you have to do. Of course, it's your product, but you gotta find that kind of authenticity in your own product. And the second reason I show it is because I figure if I end on this slide and I tell you that my wonderful team won the Palo Alto City Championship, you'll probably send me off with a pretty good round of applause because you're cheering for these kids. So thank you so much. Great to be here.
I need some traction. You need some traction. I need some traction. Let's get some traction. You need some traction. Let's get some traction.